You're watching Money Lessons, a show that helps you understand your finances and take control of your future. Today, we're joined by Jonathan Clements. He is the founder of The Humble Dollar. That is a website that teaches you everything you need to know about money, and I mean everything. Jonathan, it's great to have you with us today.
Thanks for having me on, Rhonda. I really appreciate it.
So we are focused today with you on a couple of key issues for everyone, and that is saving, spending, and investing. Now, of those three, I know that spending is probably the easiest to think about. So let's start there. How do we manage our spending? How do we take control of it? What are some of the issues we have when we start spending too much?
So of course, all three are very closely connected. The money that you don't spend is going to be available to be saved, and the savings can then be invested. So in many ways, the key to financial success starts with controlling your spending. And somehow or other, you need to find a way to spend less than you earn. That sounds easy enough. Who couldn't do that? And yet we all struggle to control our spending. And the reason we struggle is because of the way we're hardwired. You know, the financial instincts that we have, we inherited from our hunter-gatherer ancestors. Our hunter-gatherer ancestors were focused on surviving until the end of the day. They consumed whenever they possibly could. Our hunter-gatherer ancestors did not have to save diligently in 401k plans for four decades so they could retire in comfort. That was not the way they had to behave in order to survive. But for us today, in 2020, being able to delay gratification is probably the most important financial skill.
Jonathan, that is so hard because there are temptations everywhere. I mean, you know, the retailers, restaurants, you name it, they all kind of have us hooked. You get these emails, you know, buy one, the other one's 50% off. I mean, they've all figured out how to get our money away from us. How do we successfully ignore that kind of constant messaging that's out there?
Well, one of the things we have to do is think about this conflict between our current selves and our future self. And somehow or other, we need to resist the whiny demands of our current self and create sympathy for our future self. One of the great ways to create sympathy for our future self so that we make sacrifices today is to visualize what we want to achieve with our lives. You need to think about these goals, visualize these goals, and if you can make them come alive in your head, then you'll be more apt to make the sacrifices today necessary to make it happen. Now, the problem is when we're in the store, when we're online, our instincts take over and it's like, I want to consume right now. And so probably the number one thing that you can do to stop yourself in the moment is simply to pause, walk out of the store for 10 minutes, walk away from your computer for 10 minutes and think about it. Think not just about the purchase, but think about all the alternative uses of our money. Psychologists have this wonderful word, miswanting. We miswant all the time. We imagine that something will make us happy forever. We buy it, and it simply doesn't work out that way. If you don't believe me, look in your closets. Go down to the basement. Look at all the stuff you have. These are all things that you bought, imagining that they were going to make you happy forever, and yet instead, they sit in the basement, they sit in the closet, and if anything, you probably regret these purchases.
It's funny, I actually read this tip once and I tried it and it worked, and it was just whatever you want, put it in the bag online, but then don't ever buy it. I actually tried it and it did seem to work for me. You know, I owned these things for a few minutes, then I got rid of them.
So one of the things that we know from the research is that one of the greatest sources of happiness when it comes to making purchases is anticipation. So actually putting that stuff in the shopping cart but not actually buying it can be a great way to spend your time. In your head, you can buy all kinds of things. You can go on all kinds of wonderful vacations, and probably the anticipation of doing those things and daydreaming about them is actually going to give you more pleasure than actually making the purchase or actually going on the trip.
Is it harder or easier to learn good spending habits when you're younger? I mean, do we get better at this as we age? Is this something that, you know, you can graduate from high school, and if you've tackled this, you've really set yourself up for future success?
I think it takes a lot of time to learn to spend wisely. And what I mean by spending wisely is knowing what we really want from our money. And it takes thousands and thousands of disappointing purchases. You have to buy one thing after another, take it home, and realize 2 days later, this wasn't quite as life transforming as I hoped. And again, there's good research to back this up. In the realm of happiness research, there's this notion of the hedonic treadmill. And the hedonic treadmill is this. We imagine that if we get that next promotion or that next pay raise, or we buy the bigger house or the faster car, or we buy that new pair of shoes, we are going to be endlessly happy. And when we initially get these things, we get the promotion, we buy the new car, we are thrilled. And then, you know, within a few weeks, you know, the promotion is just another job title. The pay raise is just another paycheck. And the fast car, well, you just dinged it up. And suddenly these things that you thought were going to make you endlessly happy, if anything, you start to forget about it, and you start hankering off to something else, and you're back on the treadmill. And the result is that we tend to spend our lives pursuing goals that don't make us happy.
So let's talk about savings for a little bit. I mean, listen, there are people in their 30s, 40s, 50s, 60s that don't save enough and haven't figured that out. And for younger people, saving is just as difficult, if not more so. What kind of tips can you give somebody who maybe has a part-time job and is making a little bit of money? How do you help them figure out how much to save and where to save, especially now in this environment? Because, you know, back in the day, for a lot of people, their grandparents would have this little passport savings book, which don't even exist anymore. And you could put your money in the bank and make a little bit of interest on it. And that's really hard to do now in this environment.
So first of all, in order to save, you need to set yourself up to save. And one of the big problems for many Americans, young and old, is they box themselves in financially. And the way they box themselves in is with these high fixed monthly costs. They've got the big lease payment on a car. They have the big monthly mortgage payment, the big rent payment. They're paying for all of these monthly services, you know, for the gym subscription, for the music subscription, for the cable subscription. And as a consequence, there's just no money left to be saved. So the first thing you can do in order to set yourself up to be a good saver is to lower your fixed monthly costs. Go through those costs that you have and say, you know, do I really want this thing? Or can I reduce this cost and thereby create the breathing room necessary in order to save? Now, you're absolutely right. Today, if you go to the bank and you put your money in a savings account, you'll earn almost no interest. But I say to you, you go back to the 1970s and you could get a healthy amount of interest on a passbook savings account. But actually at the time, you were probably worse off after inflation and after taxes. Today, a savings account will actually probably end up putting more money in your pocket than a savings account would have back in the 1970s. And more important than just worrying about the rate of return you're going to get, you should actually think about happiness again. I know I keep coming back to this topic, but it's really important if you're going to have a contented financial life. People, I believe, have this big trade-off to make. We can give in to the whiny demands of our current self, buy this, buy that, spend our entire paycheck, and live a life of financial stress. We can put a little bit of money away for the future and have a much more contented financial life. The Consumer Financial Protection Bureau down in Washington has an ongoing project looking at financial wellness. And what they've discovered is that a key driver of our sense of financial wellness, about whether we're stressed about money every month, is simply how much money we have sitting in the bank. People who have less than $250 in what they call liquid savings, bank accounts, savings accounts, have the lowest level of financial wellness. Meanwhile, if you can put away, say, $5,000 in a savings account, in a money market mutual fund, in a checking account, your financial wellness, according to the surveys, will be substantially above average. So simply making that sacrifice, saving a little bit of money, putting it in the bank, will make you feel a whole lot better about your financial life. You'll give up the short-term thrill of those purchases, but you'll get that long-term sense of contentment.
So I will say $5,000 is a lot of money, especially for somebody just starting out. So I don't want people to feel overwhelmed when they hear that figure. But when I think about this, I think about something as simple as, let's say you go out 4 times a week and buy coffee outside. If you cut that to 3 days a week, maybe you put that little bit of money and you set it aside. And you know what? After a couple of months, it's more than a little bit of money.
Yeah, there are all kinds of little things you can do to save money. I mean, certainly through my career, I did some things like bring lunch to work occasionally. I would bring a little carafe with coffee to work so that I didn't have to buy coffee once I got to work. All of these little things add up. There are some things that each of us enjoy. And maybe for you, the special treat is the gourmet coffee. And if that's really important to you, then don't deny yourself. But you need to deny yourself something if you're going to be a good saver. So figure out what it is that doesn't matter to you that you're currently spending money on and cut that out.
Jonathan, have you seen any changes in that? A lot of people actually don't use cash for transactions anymore. People use debit cards, they use credit cards, they use Apple Pay. I mean, there's all sorts of things, but you don't often see money changing hands when you go and you're buying coffee. Does that hurt or help our saving and spending patterns, the way we're transacting?
It's a great question, Rhonda. And the answer is yes. You know, using plastic hurts our financial behavior. If you want to cut the amount that you spend, pay in cash, because it's a lot more painful to hand over dollar bills than it is to hand over a piece of plastic. Economists have discovered is we have this thing called hyperbolic discounting. And that means...
That's a big word there. A couple of big words there, Jonathan.
Yeah, hyperbolic. And don't worry, Rhonda, I'm going to explain it. Hyperbolic discounting is this notion that, you know, if we're given a choice between, say, a dollar today or $3 at the end of the week, I mean, $3 at the end of the week, you've tripled your money. It was like a fabulous rate of return. And yet a lot of people will take the $1 today. We discount the future at a very high rate. So when we put stuff on the credit card and we know we're not going to get the bill for 2 or 3 weeks, and then we're going to have another month to pay it, that's far, far into the future as far as we're concerned. And we discount that cost enormously, and it makes us much more willing to make expenditures today. So yeah, if you want to cut your spending, pay with cash.
Jonathan, for people that are just starting out, maybe they get their first job, or maybe they get a little money that's unexpected, a gift, an inheritance, something like that, it's good to invest early. We know that if you start early with investing, you will have a much better success story down the line. What advice would you give to somebody who's just thinking about that? They've got some savings. Now they actually want to invest and grow their wealth. What are some first steps that you would advise?
So the first thing you need to do if you've got some money to invest is think about why you're investing, because that's going to drive your investment strategy. If you have some money that you plan to use to make a house down payment 3 years from now, you probably shouldn't buy anything more adventurous than a money market fund or a high-quality short-term bond fund. On the other hand, if you have money that you're not going to use for 40 years because it's money for retirement, then you can take a lot more risk, and you should seriously consider putting a larger percentage of that money into the stock market. So your goals really drive your investment strategy. So first, think about your goals.
What about you're in the situation that you've been saving some money, you've got a part-time job in high school, you want to use it to college? I would assume that money stays somewhere really safe if it's right in front of you.
One of the rule of thumb is that if you're within 5 years of spending money, that money should not be in stocks. It should not be in riskier bonds. Instead, you should be putting the money in a savings account, or in those high-quality short-term bonds, in maybe a money market mutual fund. You're not going to get great returns, but given that short time horizon, you can't afford to take that sort of risk. You can't take the risk that we'll have a stock market like we had earlier in 2020 when the S&P 500 dropped 34%. You don't want to take that risk and then discover, oh, it's time to pay the college tuition bill, but unfortunately, I only have 2/3 of what I had before.
And for a lot of people, if you are lucky enough to get a job where you have benefits and you have a 401k plan or 403b plan where you work, I would assume just put in whatever you can if you're just starting out. It's going to be better than nothing.
A 401k plan or a 403b plan can be the best deal in savings. You get what I call the investor's triple play. You can get an upfront tax deduction, you get tax deferred growth, which means you don't have to pay tax on the money each year, and you may get an employer matching contribution. That means that the employer might kick in 50 cents for every dollar you contribute. That is free money. One of the worst financial mistakes you can make is to not contribute enough to a 401k plan or a 403b plan to get that full matching contribution. You've really, really got to put that money in to get that free money from your employer.
How do people in their 20s do in terms of starting investments as opposed to somebody in their 30s or 40s?
So the problem with many investors, particularly with younger investors, they tend to be overconfident. They feel like they know what they're doing. They can beat the market. They have a much higher appetite for risk than they really do. And a lot of people when they're younger end up making big financial mistakes. So if you have that 401k plan, one of the things that I would do is look to see whether it has something called target date funds. And target date funds are diversified investment mix geared to particular retirement dates. So you might be looking at a fund that is like the 2055 fund or the 2060 fund. And you can just buy that one fund, shovel all your money into it, and you're going to get this broadly diversified portfolio that's geared towards the time when you're expecting to retire, and then leave the driving to somebody else. Don't mess around with this. You know, if you really want to do something good for your finances, focus on saving more money. Don't focus on messing around with your investments. You'll regret it.
I think people really learn lessons when they hear other people's mistakes. Was there any big mistake you personally made in terms of spending, saving, and investing when you were younger that you were able to kind of correct and go on a different course?
So when I was in college, I used to rack up credit card debt during the course of the school year. And then in the summer, I would get a job, I would earn enough to pay off the credit card debt, and then I would start the cycle again. When I moved from London to the United States back in 1986, you know, I arrived here with nothing except for credit card debt. And it took me a number of years to get it paid off. But since then, I've been a good boy.
I have to ask you about the name of your website, Humble Dollar. Where did that come from? What does that mean?
The problem with a lot of people when it comes to saving and spending and investing is they think they know things that they don't. And the fact is, we don't know where the financial markets are headed. You know, we don't know what curveballs life is going to throw us. So what we should do is take a humble approach towards managing money. And what does that mean? It means we should focus on the things that we can control. We should focus on how much we save. We can control that. How much we pay in investment costs, how much we pay in taxes each year, and how much risk we take with our investment portfolio. If we are humble, we are actually more likely to end up being financially successful.
Being humble is a good thing, but what if you're a procrastinator? What advice would you give somebody who's 25 and says, hey, you know, it's gonna be years before I need to worry about anything. I got my first job. I'm going to go out. I'm going to have fun. I'm going to buy things. I'm going to live a little. I made it through college. What's the best piece of advice you can give that person?
Yeah, go out and have some fun, but try to create a little bit of sympathy for your future self. And one way you can just compel yourself to save is to sign up for automatic savings plans. And that might be automatic contributions every month to a high yield online savings account, automatically contribute to the 401k plan through payroll deduction, automatically investing in your favorite mutual funds. I mean, this is how I started out. This is how I managed to build wealth. Save that money every month, come what may, and then yeah, live it up with the money that remains. But for goodness sake, save at least a little bit for the future.
Jonathan Clements, it's been so great chatting with you on Money Lessons. Thank you so much for your time.
It's been my pleasure, Rhonda. Thank you.